humble believers are protected. Any pride prevents our spiritual protection and growth. But look what it says in James 4:6. It says, but he gives more grace. Therefore, he says, God will resist us when we're proud, but God will pour out grace on us when we're humble. So which one do we want? Do we want to keep getting stuck with the arrows and flaming doubts and fears and anxiety and lust and covetousness? Or do we want to deny all that and take the shield of faith? We'll only hold up the shield of faith if we're humbly obeying God. James says there are 10 conscious choices we should make, starting in verse 7. And each of these are imperatives. The first one, look at 7a. Submit yourself, therefore, to God. That's a constant choice to hear and submit to God. It's kind of like answering the phone. I mean, have you ever seen people do this? Their phone rings and they go, nope, don't want to talk to them. And or at home, they look at the answering machine and see the, you know, the call, you know, the caller ID, and they go, oh, don't want to talk to them. Did you know that God is waiting every day to talk to us? He sits on the other side of this book waiting to talk to us. Waiting to, what does it say in Revelation 3:20? Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anybody will answer the door, I'll come in and sup with him and I with him, and we'll have this fellowship. Jesus pictures himself standing outside the door. You know, that's always been used as a, you know, salvation message, but actually it was written to the church. And it was a message to the church that you're leaving your first love. You're leaving not being able to get enough of Christ. There's some people that watch the Home Shopping Network and the Weather Channel about 100 times more than they listen to the voice of God. And their houses are filled with junk that their kids are going to have to throw away, and they're afraid of the weather. And instead of being filled with overwhelming love for the one who gave himself for them because they listened to his voice. Look at 7b, the second half of verse 7. Resist the devil. It's a daily choice to say no to the world, my sin, my flesh, and the devil who stirs them all up. And resist him. And I'm not talking about, you know, some people are casting out the demon of, you know, of weight gaining and the demon of, you know, this and that. We're not casting out demons. We're just saying no to our flesh. Martin Luther put it this way. He says, when the devil knocks on the door, I send Jesus to answer the door and say, he doesn't want that. Look at verse 8, the first part of it, 8a. Draw near to God. It's a personal choice to chase after God in prayer. Now remember, I have a phonographic mind. If I think about it, I talk about it. When I pastored in Georgia, I used to love watching the pickup trucks. You know, Georgia pickup trucks, the big back window, the guy driving here. And if you'd get up behind him, he was kind of driving slow through the country and got close enough, you'd notice that it wasn't one person. It was like a big bump there. And what you realized is there is a guy and there's his girlfriend and she's sitting so close to him, you can't see light between them. Have you ever seen that? I mean, she's just way past the middle of the seat and sitting over right next to him. And so if you're driving behind one of them, what do you know? They're not married. Because if you get behind a pickup truck and there's someone here and someone here, you know they're married. Dating, married. When you're dating, what is it? You can't get enough. You draw near. They're just, you know what I mean? It's just sickening to watch. They're just close. But then they get married. This is just getting saved. This is most Christians. Drive behind them. Lord's over here. They're over there. It's not that they're drawing nearer and nearer and nearer to God. A personal choice to chase after God by praying, thinking about him, meditating through his word. Did you know there's a day coming for every one of us we're going to be laying in a hospital bed and they take away your ring, they take away your watch, they take away your glasses, they take everything away, most of your clothes, give you one of those funny gowns that doesn't shut in the back, and you're there and a couple tubes and everything else, something in your nose, and you're laying there. And in that moment, the only scripture you'll have is what you've spent time treasuring in your heart. Thy word have I hid in my heart, so I won't sin against you when they have all that stuff poking me. Did you know we're all headed toward a time when the Bible will not be very accessible? Do you know how long nights are in the hospital? I bet some of you do. how cold it gets, how dark, how long, all the clicking and whistling and the noises and the nurses bothering you. It's one of the greatest times in the world to take the treasury of the Word of God and just run over it in your mind. Thy words were found, Jeremiah 15:16 says, and I ate them, and thy word became for me the joy and rejoicing of my heart. Why? Because I'm called by your name. When we memorize the scripture, it rejoices and fills our hearts with wonder because it's the very voice of God that we have ingested and we know we're called by his name. That's what drawing near to God is all about. It doesn't stop there. Look at the middle of the verse, verse 8. Cleanse your hands. It's constantly changing our mind about any known sin. That's what it means to repent. A change of mind that leads to a change of behavior. Repentance starts with me choosing to say no, and it leads to a behavior. Repentance is not me doing a 180. I can't 180, but I can say, I agree with you, O God, no to that sin. And instantly, he douses me with the grace to deny that sin and follow him. And see, that's why we're supposed to cleanse our hands, change our mind about sin, which leads to a change of behavior, and purify your hearts, verse 8, ends with seeking the constant cleansing of Christ's blood. In verse 9, lament. We practice sorrow for our sin, and we mourn. I told you about John Wesley, who when he preached, there would be tear streaks running down the people's faces. Because godly sorrow, 2 Corinthians 7 tells us in verse 8 and 9, produces repentance, but the sorrow of the world produces death. The world's just sorry that they got VD or STIs or whatever, cirrhosis. They're just sorry they got it. The believer is sorry they offended God, and they mourn. And God is close to those who are of a humble and contrite heart. And he moves in and gives us a fresh new beginning. But look at verse 10. The internal awareness in verse 10. Humbling ourselves is an internal awareness that all that matters is God. Choosing to put on a humble mind about life. I measure my life not by how far up the corporate ladder I got, not how my golf score went, not how I, you know. It's what does God think? What am I going to have at the judgment seat of Christ to cast at Christ's feet? Did you know life is like going to Walmart? We all get a basket. We get to walk through, put anything in our basket we want. That's how we spend our time. But we bump our cart up at the checkout line, and we put everything up on that conveyor belt. And 2 Corinthians 5:10 says that we're all going to appear before the judgment seat of Christ, and he's going to measure what's in our cart. How does he do it? 1 Corinthians 3:10-13 says that it all is going to go through the fire. And the fire is going to burn out anything that didn't please God in our life. Not sin. There's no sin in my cart. Right now, there's no sin in my cart of my life. Why? Because Jesus already, once and for all, has taken care of all my sins, past, present, and future. All that's in my cart is what I did with life that wasn't sin. Is watching a three-hour football game sin? No. Is watching a three-hour football game sin if you didn't spend time communing with God? You can think about that one. See, it's whether we're wasting our time. That's what's going to burn up. Not sin, it's gone. It's wasted life. Those kids I met with going to India that spend 3 hours a day online, not memorizing scripture, not understanding more of the precious word of God, posting pictures of what they ate and commenting on what everybody else ate and showing off. Now, that might not be sin, but it's certainly going to burn up out of your cart. And all that's going to be left to cast before Christ is what was done in the power of his Spirit humbly for his glory. Not for me.